Piers Morgan loves to ask people if they'll condemn Hamas. Yes or no, yes or no, yes or no. And here's a clip of you asking Piers Morgan to answer a question, yes or no. Let's see how that goes.
Well, they've emerged. Oh, look, let's be clear.
And this is Piers Morgan talking about Hamas when he says they.
Emerged as a terrorist organization committing acts of mass terrorism. I mean, that's what they are.
No, Hamas is a counter-terrorist group responding to the terrorism of the IDF and responding to the terrorism of the Israeli state. A counter-terrorist group can commit war crimes, brother, but they didn't initiate it at all. Mm. If they're founded in 1988 and the terrorism began in 1948 with the state of Israel, that's 40 whole years. Yeah, and let's keep in mind.
Yeah, I think it's a stretch to call them counter. I think it's a stretch. With
undermine
respect.
The PLO, undermine secular nationalism, promote fundamentalist Islam as a way of dividing Palestinians. That's why Netanyahu allowed for Hamas to gain access to the money from Qatar and others.
Yeah, I agree.
To keep the Palestinians divided. And therefore not having to move to deal with the stuff.
Dr. West, there are many things that we would find agreement on about the way Palestinians have been treated for a very long time. It has been a completely unacceptable occupation.
Well,
it should not have dragged
up.
Hang on. Let me finish.
Vicious,
I know.
Ugly.
Let me finish. But the idea that you categorize Hamas after October 7th as counter-terrorists is ridiculous. They are terrorists. And they should be called what they are. Anyway.
But let me ask you this. Do you think the IDF is terrorists when they kill innocent Palestinians? Do you believe
I think it depends.
Yes or no, my brother? Yes or no?
Well, okay. I would ask you this. If you were.
Yes or no?
No.
Yes or no?
Hang on.
You're uncensored. You're uncensored,
yes,
my brother.
And I've been asked this question before. I have actually tweeted in 2014.
Which I thought was so refreshing because you never hear people ask yes or no. Is Israel terrorists or what they're doing terrorists? And of course, you can't, if you say what Hamas did, what Israel's doing is not terrorism. And you've been very consistent. You distinguish between killing civilians and killing combatants, which fit, which is a framework of international human rights law. But I thought it was interesting that you got him unable to respond to this, even as he, on almost every episode he's done on the subject, corners people with a yes or no. And then he tries to throw it back to you with a challenge. And this was great, too.
I tweeted that what Israel was doing then was bordering on terrorism. I'm not afraid of using that analogy.
But bordering on terrorism?
Yeah, but hang on.
The children are being killed, right?
Yes, of course. There were children killed on October the 7th. I have serious misgivings about what's happening currently in Gaza, like most people. But what I would say to you, if you were the head of the Israeli government on October the 7th, out of interest, what would your response have been to that horrendous terror attack?
Well, I'll tell you the answer to that question, but I don't know why you just can't say the IDF is terrorists, killing some innocent people, bordering on, it's wrong. No, why you're uncensored, you're a free man. Tell the truth from your soul,
little
brother.
I'm telling the truth.
Let me tell you what I would do if I was in Israel. I would end the occupation. I would end the siege. I was saying I'm committed to Palestinian dignity. I'm committed to Palestinian equality. And we Palestinians and Israelis, we Jews and Palestinians, we're going to learn how to live together in the context of equality and dignity. We're going to have Jewish safety. We're going to have Jewish security. That's the very end and aim of Israel. We'll never see an annihilation of Jews. We'll never see another massacre or holocaust of Jews. But we'll never see annihilation and massacre and vicious attacks on Palestinians either. That's what I would do.
Well, on that,
not just as head of Israel. That's what I'll do in the White House, brother. That's what I'll do in the White House. And I'll explain to American people why it is that Biden and Harris and others continue to enable this genocide. And then when they finally say ceasefire, they act like we ought to give them a moral prize.
I appreciate your moral clarity there. In response to that often rhetorical question of what is Israel supposed to do?
Undermine the conditions that make possible this kind of domination, occupation. Make sure you keep track of the humanity, beginning with the least of these, that's biblical for me, which are the oppressed, and then make a space in which oppressor can, in fact, call into question that distinction and attempt to live a life together. And that's why I'm thoroughly convinced that the two-party solution, really, even again, that Biden and Harris are talking about, is relatively empty. It's too late. There's too many settler colonialists who've taken the land, so that you end up giving the Palestinians something like a Bantustan state, a highly marginalized entity of which there's still Israeli supremacy, so the Israeli will continually have them under surveillance, have them under their power with a little small entity they call a state, and then say you ought to be satisfied with it. No, I'm not going for that. That is, it's very interesting to me that people of others, just in Dallas, had a wonderful, wonderful gathering at a rally, and people had a big, again, controversy about this phrase, to the river, to the sea. And you said, well, right now, you've got apartheid from the river to the sea. No, not controversial. But when you say river to the sea, oh, you mean annihilation of Jews? No, no, we're not going. We don't have any patience for annihilation of Jews or anybody else. But if the alternative is river to the sea with apartheid versus river to the sea with a secular state, which one has a moral character to it? Which one has ethical content to it? How do we deal with these non-negotiables, what I call non-negotiables, which is Palestinian dignity and equality and Jewish security and safety? There will never be Israeli safety. There'll never be security for Jewish brothers and sisters as long as they are occupying, dominating, subjugating, marginalizing, and degrading, and outright hating Palestinians. Then they get upset when Palestinians hate back. Well, I don't believe people ought to hate at all, but I know people do hate back. You terrorize, people do terrorize back. There's no doubt about that. And we've had these discussions in the Black Freedom Movement, my dear sister. Mm-hmm. You know, was, you know, Nat Turner and Denmark Vesey and John Brown, a white brother, were they justified in killing white innocent children? Well, that's a serious debate that Frederick Douglass and Du Bois and others had. We got disagreements with that. I tend to be very, very purist about that. I don't think we should ever kill innocent people, ever kill innocent children. If you do, you ought to recognize that's a crime against humanity. You don't just do it and walk around as if this is just what resistance is all about. No, you got to make some moral distinctions. Are you going to end up killing innocent Palestinians who disagree with you? You end up killing innocent Arabs who disagree with you. You got to have some moral corpus. But I do understand, and here Frantz Fanon's point is a powerful one, that you don't have control over this thing. And when violence is so deeply inculcated in the structures of a society, the oppressed are going to speak the language of those who are coming at them. Malcolm X has a powerful point. Frantz Fanon does too, and they're not the only two. So you have to be cognizant of that, but I'm holding on to moral, some morality and spirituality. And of course, as you know, sometimes my leftist comrades say, oh, Brother West, are you talking about both sides? I can't stand this both sideism. I understand their point. Right. You can use both siderism, downplaying the nature of the domination, downplaying the structures of oppression, and downplaying the fact that resistance movements of oppressed people takes a variety of different forms. There's no doubt about that. Now, I'm not a pacifist like Martin and King and Tutu and others. I believe combatants can kill other combatants, and you try to kill other combatants. But of course, you know, war, since war, going back to the genocide against brothers and sisters in the Congo under Leopold in Belgium, you're just killing innocent folks in such a massive way that people say, well, come on, Brother West, man. Everybody's killing innocent folk. Everybody's going to do that. Well, why you have all of this equivocation and so forth? I said, no, you know, I'm not necessarily better than anybody in any deep sense. I just want to have a witness that has some kind of morality and spirituality tied to it, even as I'm cognizant of just how vicious and ugly and bestial and barbaric these genocides and ethnic cleansings and subjugation and colonization has in fact been. And you could imagine, you know, that's the kind of thing we could talk about a long, long time.
Well, I think there's a difference between moral consistency and both sides. I think the danger is if you say life is precious, there's a difference between killing civilians and killing combatants, and both sides are doing it, which is not what you're saying. I mean, I've heard you say that you have a larger indictment. I believe that was your word. Your indictment is larger of Israel because they are committing more of these crimes. But I think that, and you also are pointing out that, what do you think is going to happen when you are inflicting violence on a daily level and a structural level? How do you expect people to respond? And there's a lot of nonviolent resistance from Palestinians. No one ever talks about that.
That's exactly right. I mean, in my Radical King book, I make the connection between the Antifada, the first Antifada was nonviolent. Second Antifada was primarily nonviolent. And of course, we also have to tell the truth about the ways in which the American empire and the Israeli elites tried to repress, suppress, and crush PLO, which was a secular leftist movement, which was nationalist but tied to a leftist analysis, and used fundamentalist Islam as a replacement, thinking that somehow that was going to be either easier to control, or it was somehow going to be something that allowed them to get away with their colonial position, their position as, in this case, oppressors vis-a-vis the oppressed. And it backfired on us, part of the blowback. We saw it in Afghanistan, you see it in the Middle East, you see it in Egypt, across the Middle East. You crush the leftist possibilities, you support. I mean, that's Saddam Hussein and Bin Laden, all of them were on CIA pay list, because they were being manipulated by these imperial powers, a Senate in Washington, D.C. And then it backfires on them, and they become anti-American empire, which is not anti-imperialist as a whole, because they could be tied to other kind of imperialism, and that's a complicated thing too.